So I was going to start the show out with a whole joke about how, like, Connor and I were still arguing. I was going to, like, start it out by just being like, see, and that's why you're such a, you know, and, like, then be like, oh, hey, we're live.
You don't get it, Zane. Yeah.
But I have legit reasons to be mad at you, so that joke doesn't really play well in my mind right now.
I'm late. I'm late again.
So, anyway... We are here with the MMA Vivisection and my co-hosts, Connor Rebisch, and we are going to talk about UFC on Fox 19 and break down a bunch of fights and give a bunch of fight odds and way too much analysis on all this because that's how we roll. And on a card that has changed dramatically since it was first announced.
See, I was just trying to get everybody into the spirit of UFC Tampa. Because a lot of things that you thought were going to happen aren't going to happen when you thought they were going to happen. So that's why that's I was right. Late.
That's right. There you go. See, it's meta-analysis right there. We're going to do a shitty job to emphasize the shitty things that have happened to this card.
At least we don't have to talk about Dan Henderson being slain by... Well, did you see what they replaced the Machida fight with, actually?
Yes.
There's talk about having him fight... Hector Lombard.
Yeah, that's not going to be good.
The least you can say is thank God Hector will put him out with only one punch.
Yeah, I know. Somebody was like, I saw somebody legit today being like, but if Hendo survives that first round, he's going to win. And it's like, have you seen Henderson?
Guy, he's not going to survive the first round. I'm sorry.
No.
Every fight's a bummer these
days. I mean, he hasn't survived the first round in any fight since Daniel Cormier in 2014, and that Daniel Cormier fight is not one you want to be comparing to anything.
Yeah. But hey, this card, it's still here.
It's still here. We've got a lot to talk about, so I'm not going to mince too many more words. Let's just dive straight into the fight past prelims and Elazu Zaleski dos Santos versus Omari Akhmedov.
This is a pretty damn fun looking fight. It really should be a blast, a really good way to kick off the card. And I do want to say, like, this whole card, even with all the injury pullouts, is pretty strong from top to bottom. It's definitely a better undercard, prelims and undercard main card fights included, than UFC 197's undercard, which kind of sucks until the main card starts. Elizio dos Santos, he's faster than Omari Akhmedov. He seems a little more naturally athletic in that he can kind of change up his rhythm. Akhmedov has this problem where he just kind of throws all power punches at the same speed without variation every single time. He's aggressive and he hits hard. And he can take a good shot, and he can fight pretty well even after he's tired, like a lot of great Russian wrestlers, too. You know, they tend to be like – he's like the classic Russian Olympic wrestler. He's big and strong and powerful. He gets really tired, but he guts it out despite that. But I think Elizio Zaleski dos Santos is going to have his moments in this fight. The problem for him is going to be stopping Akhmedov's takedowns. Akhmedov can hit a really well-timed double leg, and I think that's going to be the saving grace for him in breaking the rhythm of Dos Santos, keeping him from really taking over. And I think he's a little better on the ground than, say, Nicholas Dalby was, the last guy who kind of took Zaleski Dos Santos down with ease. So I'm going to say Omari Akhmedov, but I think it's going to be a really hard-fought win for him.
Yeah, I think my pause with that would be that Omari Akhmedov's success on the mat has largely came on a Russian circuit where, like, the grappling there is just different. Like, it's generally behind the curve of what we see in other strong MMA circuits. There's not a lot of BJJ. There's a lot of very fast, like, I'm going to jump on an armbar because I see an armbar grappling.
A lot of
sprint grappling, which is good for MMA, but it doesn't make Akhmedov a very good control grappler from top position. Like, he's a guy who he can get you down, but then he's probably going to give up position pretty quickly going for something. And I think if he does that, I mean, Zaleski, I think Zaleski can weather that. And I kind of feel like, especially just with that, like getting knocked out by Sergio Moraes, that does not inspire a lot of confidence for me. I think the thing for me is that it there's a very good chance. Both these guys have big power. They both have the basic mechanics for power punching that they're not just going to, it's not just like, oh, maybe I'll get lucky and swing one of my club hands at you and knock you out. But they both throw with enough consistency and accuracy that it's very likely somebody's going to get finished in this fight.
Yeah, I tried not to, with Akhmadov, go the route of, you know, you're only as good as your last fight. Because it so often is not true, but it is difficult to look at him in a matchup with a guy with 11 of his 14 wins by KO and be like, you'll be fine when he got one punch KO'd by a guy not known for his striking skill or even really his power.
Well, yeah, and I mean, beyond that, he got knocked out by Sergio Moraes. He retired Brian Ebersole at the end of his career with a knee injury. Mm-hmm. He beat a guy who then immediately retired in Mats Nilsson, and then he lost to Gunnar Nelson.
And he was hurt by Gunnar Nelson before that submission.
Yeah. And so, last clean KO was of the very clean KO-able Thiago Perpetuo. That was the last time he clean knocked somebody out. And I think the big thing is that, like you said, with him having such a set rhythm and not necessarily the highest output in that rhythm, I think even though he's got danger and power in his punches, it's just there's not enough surprise to catch someone way off guard.
I think he matches the output of his opponent to a large degree. Like when he fought Nilsson put a ton of pressure on him. And he threw a lot of punches in that fight. And that's part of the reason why he is easy to tire out. But I don't know that Zaleski dos Santos is that high of an an output fighter.
Zaleski, I think he's a pretty good swarmer. Like, he's very much in the, like, I'm going to throw a couple things, and the moment something lands, I'm going to throw seven more punches.
Yeah. But he does kind of fight in bursts rather than, like...
he fights in bursts.
Yeah.
And I just feel like the ability for him to surprise Akhmadov and to change speeds and to catch him with something, I have a lot more faith in that kind of taking round, doing enough to eventually hurt Akhmadov. Like, I have enough faith in him being able to just crack him with a surprise speed change. The other side of that is that because he is going to crack him and then swarm, there's going to be a lot of opportunities for him to get countered really hard. And... so it's kind of, that's where this fight really becomes a toss-up for me. But because I haven't seen Zaleski get stopped yet, I have more faith in his ability to ride out the swarm than I do Akhmadov's, I guess. So yeah, I'm going to go with Zaleski here. The odds on this fight are Omari Akhmadov is the favorite, minus 150, minus 165 down to minus 147. Eliza Zaleski is the underdog, plus 130. I keep reading the first number. So plus 120 up to plus 135. So it's a pretty close, tight odds. I think that's fair given how much power these guys have and the fact that they're both kind of defensively, especially when they're throwing, they both can be defensively loose fighters. Well... okay, that's not even correct. Zaleski is defensively loose when he throws. When he's throwing, he tends to put his head in the air and just kind of chuck some leather. And he's actually pretty defensively sound when he's not throwing. And Akhmadov, when he's not throwing, is defensively poor because he tends to just kind of wait and see what his opponent's going to do. And he gets caught looking. But when he is actually throwing, he tends to be a little more sound. So both guys have defensive holes. Both guys have offensive ability. There's a lot going on there.
It's a good fight.
Yeah. It's a good fight, good tight fight. I'm just gonna trust Zaleski to ride out more bad spots than I am Akhmadov. I think if Akhmadov gets put in trouble, I have less faith in him surviving it. And that brings us to Oluwale Bamgbose versus Cezar Ferreira. And man,
this is a two true outcome fight.
Yes, this is a very true outcome fight. Fajera, if he can make a fight last longer than a round, he can win it. If he can't, it's probably because he got sparked. And Bamgbose is a fighter who tends to either win early or we haven't seen him do anything other than win early. He's or also lose lost early. Early or we've, lose early.
Yeah, never seen him even in the fifth minute of a fight. He's never even seen the end of a first round.
I think he saw the second round once. If I remember, let me see if that's correct.
As a pro, it's all been first rounders.
No, you're right. It's all been first rounds. And I remember watching I think I saw his Devin Morris fight, which is his longest fight to date. And he looked really tired by the time he was at the end of those 3 minutes.
Yeah, yeah. And his longest fight is what, like 3 minutes, 14 seconds?
Yep.
Yeah, so it's hard to trust him, but then we got Cezar Fajeda in there.
Yeah, I'm going to pick Bamgbose just off of, I guess, off that Serafian fight, where Serafian's a pretty tough, durable, consistent, you know, ugly fighter to get in there with, and Bamgbose just put it on him quickly and powerfully. And Fajera is the kind of guy who can and will get caught doing that, you know, just by exactly that kind of thing. Like an exciting early first round finisher is exactly the kind of guy who beats Fajera over and over and over again. You look at, I mean, other than Thiago Santos, who's grown tons. The fighters he's beat are Andrew Craig, Daniel Serafian, and Sergio Moraes, who all have some power and some ability, but aren't necessarily like dynamic early KO threats.
Yeah, I actually got Fajeda and Santos confused when I first saw this matchup. And I was like, oh, Bamgbose is going to get killed. Thiago Santos has gotten so good. And I was like, wait, oh, it's the guy who beat Thiago Santos. Never mind. Yeah. Not exciting anymore. It's I will say the one thing in Cezar Fajeda's favor, and the reason why I picked him here, because I do think this is kind of a toss-up. It's like Oluwale Bamgbose gets out of the first round and loses, or he beats Fajeda in the first round. That's the only way this happens. The reason I like Fajeda is because I think in that Serafian fight, I think he did demonstrate that unlike guys like Serafian, he has a mind for strategy. He knows how to play a fight safe. He knows how to press his advantages. He was bigger than Jorge Masvidal when they fought. He mashed him against the cage. Now Masvidal's a killer, and he ended up adapting and knocking Fajeda out, and that's the problem. But Bamgbose does not have the depth of skill of a Bamgbose doesn't have the depth of skill of a Masvidal. He doesn't even have the depth of skill of a Daniel Serafian. He just happened to be a better striker than Daniel Serafian for 2 minutes, you know, like he doesn't have that. So I think Fajeda immediately mashes him against the fence as much as he can, drags him down. I think he submits him in the second round, if not at the end of the first. But like Bamgbose lands one shot and it's over. So it's a really tough one to call either way.
Yeah. I just, you know, it's knockouts to CB Dolloway and Elvis Mutapchic, who is not actually a great KO artist.
Nope. Yeah.
And I don't know. This is what I think. This is the fight Bamgbose wins that gets him a stupid fight that he absolutely could never win.
Yeah. He beats Fajeda and gets matched against Gegard Mousasi or some shit like that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That is my feeling here, is that this is that trap fight that he wins where the UFC's like, oh, you beat that guy, huh? Well, why don't you try this?
Then they give him Thiago Santos. They're like, oh, you beat the guy who beat Thiago Santos. Now fight him. And Santos just kicks his head off in 30 seconds. Yeah, it's, you know, I like a lot of what Bamgbose brings to the table. I've described him as this in the past. I think I did on Heavy Hands this week, but I think he is like the super powerful Emmanuel Newton. He has this weird, awkward style of striking, but he hits like a tank. But like, I just haven't seen enough of his game to know to trust him yet. I could trust him against a guy like Serafian And even though Fajita is less durable than Serafian, I think he's smarter than Serafian, and that'll pay off here.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. I'm going with Bamboosh. Just I'm taking the gut on this one and saying Bamboosh pulls it off. I also do expect that Bamboosh is going to grow incredibly rapidly in the UFC. I have
he definitely this could
feeling that he could.
How old is he?
He's actually not young. So, which kind of makes me feel like he has more chance to grow quickly, Frank. I mean, I know that's counterintuitive. He's 28.
Yeah, that's not too old for a middleweight.
No, it's not too old for a middleweight. And he's only been fighting since 2013, late or mid-2013. He had one fight.
Yeah.
So he's as raw and young as any raw as any fighter can be in the UFC, which makes this fight stupid and something he should lose, but it made the Serafian fight stupid and something he should lose too. So,
middleweight, baby.
Yeah, middleweight. Bamboos is a favorite here, and that, I don't know. Like, don't bet on this fight.
No, don't bet on either of these first two, even though I think they both should be fun. Don't bet on them.
Bamboos is the favorite here, minus 190 down to minus 170. Cezar Ferreira is the underdog, plus 158 down to plus 135. This is, like we said, this is a two outcome fight. Either Bamboos wins early or he loses.
And while I get picking Bamboos, I've got to think those odds reflect a sort of what have you done for me lately attitude. Yeah, because Fajed has been knocked out. Yeah.
They're hype odds, and I don't know. I'm picking Bamboos just because I have this gut feeling that he's going to put on another highlight reel performance. And, well, he already got the Uriah Hall fight, and they're just going to throw him another fight like that where he's just going to...
Oh, my God. I forgot that was his fucking debut. They put him against Uriah Hall. Why? What's the thought process there?
Yeah, Uriah Hall, for all the crap he gets, is tough as hell. Mm-hmm. And just absolutely wrecked Bamboos.
Uriah Hall's a good fighter. He's just not as elite as we want him to be, but he's very good.
And that brings us to Randy Brown versus Michael Graves.
I love this fight. I think it's awesome. This is what they do with prospects. You want to give them their first real test, put them against somebody else who's also incomplete, also inexperienced. Don't match them with some 20-fight veteran in their fifth fight. It's also a really fun style matchup and a really fun build matchup because we have Randy Brown, the striker with the boxing background, who is, I think, 6'3". He's a massive welterweight and very long. And then they got Michael Graves with the wrestling background and the wrestling fighting style, who's 5'10". And I think Brown has like an 8-inch reach advantage, but Graves has that kind of style where he's going to get in low and try to come in past those punches anyway. So I think I think it's a really interesting fight. I get the sense that Graves just has a little bit more of a complete game at this point. I can definitely picture in my mind him getting stuck on the end of Brown's reach probably after the first round when Brown has seen enough of him to know what to do, like he did in that Dwyer fight. Was it Matt Dwyer? I can see that. Brown seems to have a good nose for adaptation and finding his openings, finding his rhythm and his range. But I think at the very least, Graves is going to win the first round. And I think if he wins the first, his chances are much better of winning the second. Graves is, he fights out of a very good camp in ATT. Randy Brown kind of fights in the middle of nowhere for now. Graves has a very well integrated MMA game. He's not Khabib Nurmagomedov, but he knows how to hit on the breaks. He knows how to blend his strikes with his takedowns. He knows how to strike on the ground and in the scrambles. So, you know, if he gets stuck on the feet with Randy Brown, he will probably be in trouble, but I don't envision that happening. And unless Randy Brown like knocks him out with a counter knee or a counter uppercut while he's shooting, I think Graves can win a decision.
Yeah, I think my biggest moment of pause in that is that I guess he beat Vicente Luque, didn't he? Yeah, that's right.
Both of these Luque guys fought 5 tall fighters in their UFC debut.
So, yeah, Graves, I mean, Graves is somebody, I remember he came off tough and everybody was like, oh, this guy's trash. Like, they just had people had no faith in him at all.
I
picked him over Luque.
So did I, and I remember thinking it was weird that Luque was favored.
Yeah, and it's just because Graves is, he's so aggressive and durable and well-rounded. He's just like, he's one of those pathologically aggressive young fighters. A guy who will go after you at any angle, at any time, with anything. I think because of that, he's not going to get stuck outside. Because he is so just, like, you watch his pre-UFC fights, and it's all just like, I'm going to bum rush you into the cage, and then I'm going to stick to you and throw you around and throw any punches I can and wrestle you to the ground and be as aggressive as I possibly can everywhere. And it never lets up. He's got great, solid, you know, very solid cardio doing that. He's got a very just swarming style. And yeah, that should be the kind of thing to trouble Randy Brown right now.
Yeah.
Because Brown is definitely a fighter who is going to thrive when he can force you to wait for him. When he can make you try to guess what's coming and guess what he's going to do.
Yes.
Or like in the Dwyer fight, you know, where Dwyer just kind of got in these long clinch exchanges trying to wear him down and trying to outlast him on the feet, and that just wasn't going to happen. Great, or Brown does have really good cardio. Like, that's a very solid point in his favor, is that he's not the kind of fighter that you can just wait for him to get tired on the feet. He's also the other pause for me is that Brown's not actually that bad at stuffing takedowns. Like, he will make people work really hard to take him down. And he's got a good, strong, like, he's got some powerful clinch game because he's a good athlete. He has a really fast trigger in the clinch. So he can land some really hard shots. So, I don't know. Part of me says I should pick Michael Graves because he's tough and aggressive and swarming. But, I don't know. Brown, I don't think Graves has the ability to trouble Brown standing up as much as Dwyer did that allowed him to take the first round. I think Graves is going to have to depend a lot more on really owning the clinch, especially because Graves really likes, seems to like to get body lock takedowns. Those are his go-to. And I don't know that that's going to be,
you know what's really weird,
against a fighter that much taller than him.
You know what's really weird?
What?
It looks like Michael Graves is actually the shortest opponent Randy Brown's ever fought.
Yeah.
He's fought a bunch of other really tall welterweights. So I wonder if he'll actually even be comfortable fighting a really small guy.
He might not be. But he might also, it might also just be like one of those things where, you know, everybody was like, oh, well, you know, how's John Jones going to handle Daniel Cormier's wrestling? And it's like, well, he tends, you know, with the fighter that much taller, like, it's a lot harder to make some of that game work.
And different kinds of wrestlers, though. If you're a leg attack wrestler, then it makes it easier.
Yeah. Was Graves a leg attack wrestler?
I think so. I think he's got a good shot. I think that's his main, like, his single and double are, I think, his most reliable takedowns, from what I recall. Not like Cormier, who's like high crotches and body locks and
like defensive. I kind of feel like wrestling. Graves is more on the body lock end of things, but maybe I'm just judging too harshly off his last
No,
fight.
I'll have to. I may be remembering incorrectly.
Because that, I guess that would be what it comes down to. Is Graves going to really shoot in low on Brown? And if he does, can he turn the corner enough and change things up enough to get past Brown's first layer of takedown defense, which is pretty solid? Or is he going to try to body lock somebody that's way taller than him and way longer than him and take him down that way, which might end up causing him more problems? I'm going to go with Randy Brown on this. I think that the striking, I just don't think that Graves has the striking to hurt Brown early the way that Dwyer did and force Brown out of his comfort zone in that way. And I think that if Graves just tries to make this a pressure fence game, Brown's too athletic there and too able to make guys work hard and to land hard shots for Graves to just win out through dogged toughness.
Yeah.
Like if Brown was the kind of fighter to get tired, I would pick Graves. But I haven't seen Brown get tired yet, so
I think this is the kind of fight where Graves loses the third round.
Yeah.
Because I think Graves is going to have to fight a really high-intensity fight to take those first two off him, and I do think Brown's going to be able to outlast him.
Yeah. The odds on this are really even. Randy Brown is minus 105 down to minus 115, and Michael Graves is minus 102 down to minus 125. So it's basically a dead-even fight. I think that that makes sense. I think it's a really tough fight to pick because both guys are, they have very different skill sets and they are, you know, very different body types, very different skill sets, and they're both coming off good wins.
And both young and inexperienced enough that we don't know how much they'll improve between fights at this point. They're both 25, I think.
Yeah, they're both really young talents. They both have a lot of growing to do, so it's a tough fight to pick. Should be an exciting one. All right, much easier fight to pick now. John Dodson versus Manny Gamburyan.
Did we miss Drew Dober versus Islam Makhachev, or is that further
That's
along?
That's the first fight on the Fox prelims.
Okay, all right. What I'm seeing. Which one's this? Oh, because everything got rearranged, right? John Dodson, Manny Gamburyan.
Oh, I think I'm supposed to talk about this first. So.
Oh, go for it.
Okay, to my mind, Manny Gamburyan showed up a lot better than I thought he would. Mm-hmm. I'll say that right off the bat. He had a great win over Cody Gibson, choking him out, coming from behind, you know, letting Cody Gibson's aggression and unchecked aggression and experience take over, and then choking Gibson out. And then he just handled Scott Jorgensen, beat him. Unfortunately, what we've seen out of Jorgensen is a fighter that was pretty thoroughly, you know, beat down at that point. Like, just very worn. Maybe not chinny to the point of being, like, one punch and out, but just super shop-worn. Things were not clicking for Jorgensen at that point. And John Dodson, I do not see any signs of that with Dodson. Like, he's a hair's breadth less than the fighter he was the first time he fought Demetrius Johnson, maybe? Like, maybe he was just a little less that guy the second time he fought Demetrius Johnson.
It's hard to even tell, you know?
Yeah. But he's still at the very, like, top five level athlete, elite, well-rounded, powerful, good everywhere, no real holes in his game at all. And Manny Gamburyan, I just don't see an opportunity that Manny Gamburyan takes over anywhere. Like, he's not faster. He's not a better wrestler. He's probably an equivalent grappler. And he's not a better striker. And that's about it. So I've got to take John Dodson. And, you know, maybe Dodson doesn't finish him. Maybe. Dodson's been. Nah, actually, I'm going to pick Dodson to TKO him. Frankly, he TKO'd John Moraga, who's a pretty tough, with a doctor stoppage in a fight. He was just absolutely blasting him. And Moraga's a tough dude. Formiga's a tough dude. He TKO'd Dillashaw. Dillashaw is obviously a super tough dude. I don't see why he can't knock out Manny Gamburyan either. So.
Yeah, I think it'll kind of end up being a replica of the Jose Aldo knockout where Gamburyan overextends and gets countered because like to beat John Dodson, Manny Gamburyan would have to do a few things, many of which are against type. One, he would have to be able to score takedowns, I think, and it's probably not going to happen. He's a little bigger, but it's again, Manny Gamburyan is he's strong and he's got this like he's got that Dennis Seaver troll physique where he's got a lot of muscle packed onto this small frame. So he probably will feel bigger than the opponents Dodson is used to fighting. But also, just getting a hold of Dodson in the first place is not going to be easy for him. He does not have the speed of a Demetrius Johnson or even of a Zach Mikowski. You know, he's not that quick on his feet. Second, which he does not do, is he'd have to throw in volume. He would have to swarm him and throw a lot of shots. And Manny Gamburyan is a pretty decent striker, but he's one strikes. You know, single strikes, almost always, maybe two, if it's a quick flash of a jab and then the right hand. And I think that is just going to be an invitation for a guy like John Dodson, who is not a very high-volume fighter himself and who likes to counterpunch to just wait for that single strike where Gamburyan overreaches on a right hand and Dodson jumps in and plunges that left through the guard and puts him out. So, yeah, I think John Dodson, TKO, maybe second round.
Yeah.
Go on.
I was going to say, I can easily see it be a situation where, like, Dodson maybe even hurts Manny Gamburyan and then is able to, like, hit a fancy takedown and just blasts him from back control until they stop the fight or something like that.
Yeah, and I can also see it, like, even if it's a TKO, I can see it being really boring.
Yeah.
Because I don't know what it is. I don't really enjoy watching John Dodson fight. I think he's watching him annoys me because he has all this athletic talent, but no process. Like
he's a classic old school Jackson Wink fighter of
the
really good sides of their gym and the bad sides, in that they really make guys take good use, like, emphasize their athleticism, throw a lot of big flashy stuff, all that kind of thing, and they keep somebody like Dodson or like a Dodson in check mentally of like, don't just go crazy and do stupid stuff, because Dodson lost a bunch of fights too, I believe, if I'm like,
he's lost 7 fights, yeah.
He lost a bunch of fights early in his career coming up, so he really needed that check of like, no, actually stay in control. Don't lose to Pat Runez, you know? But at the same time, yeah, they didn't, you know, like, he doesn't have like a really set, like, you know, if you think of how does John Dodson fight, you just imagine a little like guy bouncing all over the cage and occasionally landing something huge.
Yeah, I don't want to get in trouble, but he's not a Brandon Gibson era Jackson Winklejohn fighter. He is a Mike Winklejohn era fighter. Like, he's just got that kind of single strike mentality, that kind of I'll try something crazy now. Let 30 seconds go by. Now I'll try something crazy. Like Pat was saying on Heavy Hands, he was watching the Kovsky fight, and a minute went by without any contact, and John Dodson didn't even faint once during that minute. Like, he just watched Zach Makhachev and kind of stayed way out of range. It's like, what are you doing, John? Like, make something happen, gather some information, something. He's just...
And if anything, though, maybe he's had some time with Gibson and that'll have, you know, put a little extra spark in him.
Maybe, but I mean, I would find his weirdness endearing if he wasn't so obviously talented, because he's so athletic and so powerful and so fast that I'm like, man, he could be so good. And instead of just bumming me out. But anyway, he is going to knock out Manny Gamburyan.
Odds on this fight, Dodson's the heavy, heavy favorite, minus 485 up to minus 570. Gamburyan, the underdog, plus 444 down to plus 325. And I'm not even going to argue with that, honestly.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah. That brings us, that's the end of the Fight Pass prelims, deep Fight Pass card this time. That brings us to the Fox prelims, Drew Dober, Islam Makhachev. And take it away.
I love this matchmaking as a comeback fight for Islam Makhachev, because boy did he get ruined in terrible fashion by Adriana Martins. Another example of UFC matching a young prospect up against someone way too experienced and way too dangerous way too soon. I did think Makhachev could have won that fight, but I also knew it was really dangerous. Drew Dober, not dangerous. That's the good thing for Makhachev. He is not a one-punch knockout artist. He is not a submission artist. He's not a finisher, but he is good. And he's very tough, and he's very game, and he's more experienced against elite opposition than Makhachev. So that does give him an edge, and I think it makes him just enough of a test that Makhachev has to take him seriously while still giving him enough openings to win. I do think Makhachev is going to be able to close the distance. He's going to be able to use his clinch game and show off his superior grappling. And I think I actually picked up my Sherdog preview by decision, but I kind of think he might submit Drew Dober.
He might. Yeah. Dober's unfortunate problem for him is that even as good as he can be and as competitive as he can be, he's always going to be like a slim margin winner unless he's fighting somebody like Scott Holtzman, who's just so raw that he can't make any functional, he doesn't have a functional way forward in the fight.
Yeah, it's like Michael Bisping. Like, if you don't have that some area of your game where you can like dramatically and dynamically change the way the fight is going in an instant, then you need to be extremely good to win by large margins. You need to be a Floyd Mayweather or a Willie Pep. You need to be like way better than your opposition at controlling the fight, and that's not Drew Dober.
Yeah, the lighter you get, the more and more difficult it is to be that kind of dude. I mean, there's Dominic Cruz, and how many other people rarely ever stop someone and almost always win?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you're getting into, like, there's Jose Aldo, too, and he used to be an amazing finisher. Like, he came up as an amazing finisher and just kind of dialed it back and was able to scare people off. So, you know. Drew Dober is not that guy. He's a volume kickboxer who is not a great wrestler and is not a great grappler. He's learning these things. He's becoming better at them, but he's never going to be great at them. And, you know, he ended up actually, like, that was kind of the big way he pushed that Holtzman fight was his wrestling. Like, he just went in and took Holtzman down. And with Makhachev, like, that's not your way forward.
No.
So, and I actually went back and watched that Makhachev Martins fight really briefly, and Makhachev did get shit kicked in the end, because, like, there was a moment where Makhachev shot in on Martins' hips, and Martins just kind of, like, turned a little and pushed him, and Makhachev went, like, 5 feet past him, and you're like, okay, well, shit. Man's dead in there. Like, there's because Martins is amazingly tough to take down and just a huge tank. But before that happened, Makhachev actually did, like, clip Martins hard a couple times with some big overhand punches, some well-timed strikes, the kind of things that are going to probably push Dober to try and wrestle, to try and do something other than just volume kickbox. And I think if he does that, he'll end up even worse off. So I got to take Makhachev. I don't know that he'll submit Dober. He might. I don't. You know, he did submit Leo Kuntz, but Kuntz is also a lot rawer in the rest of his game than Dober. And I feel like Dober is improving in rounding out his game. But he could also, like, just overwhelm Dober for a TKO or something like that. Like, I'm going to pick him by decision, but I think it could end up being a very overwhelming victory. The odds on this fight, Makhachev is the favorite, minus 180 to minus 205. Drew Dober, the underdog, plus 169 down to plus 145. I honestly think that's a little narrow given the style matchup, but with Makhachev coming off a bad loss, it's understandable.
Yeah, I agree.
And that brings us to Court McGee versus Santiago Ponzinibbio. And
it's a weird fight.
It is a weird fight. When I looked at this at first, I was like, you know, I think Court McGee's, like, this could be a pretty good shot for Court McGee to take this, and he's durable and functional and Court McGee. And
he's Court McGee.
It's then true. I kind of thought more about Santiago Ponzinibbio, and I think this is a really good fight for him. Like, Court McGee is tough and will stay on Ponzinibbio and will make this a tough, ugly fight. But McGee is not, like, he's not a fantastic wrestler at all. He's a functional one. Like, he wrestles by being tough and making you hit him, and then he gets in and, like, body locks you and grinds you against the fence and just kind of, you know, shoots down for a single or a double, and then you know, brute strengths you to the ground. But he's not the kind of guy who, like, you're swinging away, and so he's just going to hit that, like, awesome reactive double and put you on your back. That's right. Not Court McGee. And that would be, that's the big problem for Santiago Ponzinibbio, is somebody, like, in his fight with Andres Stahl, for instance, who has a really fantastic reactive takedown game. Stahl was able to take him down a couple of times, and Ponzinibbio just kind of shot right back up and put hands on Stahl. And I think McGee, he's so dependent on generating volume and trying to wear out his opponent. And Ponzinibbio is just, he's too powerful. He's able to punch in combination. He's got just enough of the tools to, I think, counter McGee's volume with hard enough shots to make this fight really tough on McGee. Like, Ponzinibbio, you kind of... Like, I just don't see McGee being enough of... you kind of have to be a Lorenz Larkin to beat Ponzinibbio. You have to be a next-level athlete, somebody that can stay outside and really pick him apart, because Ponzinibbio is not the fastest, most athletic guy in the world. He's got some quick power in his hands, but he's not somebody that's just, he's just not an elite athlete. And if you're not that guy, then, I don't think that McGee is enough Ryan LaFleur to beat him. So I'm going to pick Ponzinibbio. I'm not going to say he might not knock him out because McGee is stupid tough, but I'm going to say Ponzinibbio.
Here. It's funny because I actually went the opposite direction from you on this fight, because when I first saw this matchup, I was like, oh, Ponzinibbio. Ponzinibbio, power puncher, puts on a lot of pressure, throws good volume. Court McGee still had that layoff. And then I remembered Court McGee's fight with Robert Whittaker. And how well he did against such a really good boxer. And I watched that fight live, and I remember thinking that Robert Whittaker should have won it. And I think many people agreed, but Court McGee took everything Robert Whittaker had for him and dealt with it just fine. He may have stumbled a few times, but he kept coming. And I do expect him to look a little better than he did in his most recent fight. I think he had a little bit of ring rust in that Marcio Alexander fight. I think he's going to look a little more like the old Court McGee now that he's having it's promising that he didn't wait too long before getting his second comeback fight or second fight after his comeback. So the thing is, I think Ponzinibbio needs to really put pressure on opponents to win. And I think if Court McGee is coming after him and trying to pressure him and trying to make it ugly, he doesn't necessarily need to be Ryan LaFleur with these slick takedowns in order to do that. And I do think that when Ponzinibbio matches that kind of pace, he does tend to fade a little bit in the later portions of fights, because he throws a lot of power and a lot of volume when he throws. He's a great combination puncher. I like the fact that he hits as hard as he does, but it does take a toll on you. So I'm with you in terms of how close this fight is and how hard it is to call. I think Court McGee will win, and I think it'll be a really, really close decision. In fact, I think it'll be as close as the Whittaker fight, if a little more in McGee's favor. So I'm going to say Court McGee by split decision.
Yeah, that is the thing, is that he is so durable and active and pressuring that he does have the ability to take rounds. It's just that it's one of those things where it's like he takes rounds without generating a ton of really functional offense.
Yeah.
And that makes it very, very chancy. I'm going to side with Ponzinibbio just because I was like, he beat Marcio Alexandre Jr., but that was not a very pretty performance. Yeah. And I think Ponzinibbio, it's true, Whittaker is a better fighter than Ponzinibbio, without question. But I don't know. I have a feeling that Ponzinibbio can do enough early to survive late, but maybe not.
It's possible. Yeah, it is. McGee does have that thing where it's like, I won the round because I hit your gloves 100 times more than you hit my chin. not always a clean scorer, but he does put a lot of business out there.
Yeah, it's a tough one. So it's definitely a really close fight. My first thought was honestly on McGee's side of like, oh no, McGee has the durability and the pressure to take this. And then I just don't know if I feel like he's enough of the right kind of fighter to beat Ponzinibbio, but maybe Ponzinibbio is not enough of the right kind of fighter to beat Court McGee.
It's a weird fight. It feels a lot like middleweight fight for about taking place at 170.
The odds on this one, Ponzinibbio is the favorite, minus 152 down to minus 165. Court McGee is the underdog, plus 138 down to plus 125. That brings us to Bethe Correia versus Raquel Pennington. And I feel like I know from the outset which way you're going on this, but tell me and confirm.
I like both of these fighters.
Yep.
Betch Kohei has gotten some undeserved hate for her getting smashed by Ronda Rousey. It's almost like since Ronda Rousey lost to Holly Holm, now Ronda Rousey has become a scrub. So now anyone she beat really sucks. As if Alexis Davis is not a good fighter. As if Sarah Kaufman and Misha Tate, who's the champion, aren't good fighters. Kat Zingano. Yeah, of course. These are all very good fighters for this division. Betch's problem is that she is not athletic. It's quite a running joke, the little gif of her jumping around before the Ronda Rousey fight. She's not an athlete. She's not very coordinated. She doesn't have a lot of power, a lot of speed, a lot of strength. Despite that, I think she's a pretty disciplined striker. She keeps nice volume. She moves laterally a lot. She moves off of her punches and doesn't ever stick around in the pocket too long. She has a decent jab, good left hook. Nice low kicks, nothing very powerful, doesn't do any of these things very quickly, doesn't very rhythm a lot, none of these athletic, these explosive athlete things, but she's good at the things that she does. Raquel Pennington, however, is bigger and stronger and a little grittier. I think that, Pennington struggles too from not necessarily being a very process-oriented fighter at times. She's a little aimless at certain points in fights, but when you bring it to her, she responds very, very well. The toughest moments she had with Holly Holm were quickly followed by her best moments, and that's how a lot of her fights are. When you really give her trouble, she comes back hard. Her record really does not describe how good of a fighter she is. So I'm going to go with Rocky Pennington. I think, I think Correia could win this fight. Everyone's like, oh, it's easy. Rocky Pennington's going to smash her. I think Correia could totally keep Pennington at range and win this fight. But I think ultimately Pennington's going to get to the clinch and it's going to be a wash from there. So I think Pennington by submission, guillotine or naked choke, something late in the fight.
Yeah. I think actually I started this when I asked you thinking I was going to lean towards Correia actually, because for my own part, I have a long-standing distrust of Raquel Pennington. But
Did you think I was going to pick Pennington or Correia?
I knew you were going to pick Pennington. That wasn't ever a question.
See, other people know I like Correia, and nobody else seems to, so I think everyone else assumes that I'll pick Correia in any fight.
No, I like Correia. I like Correia, too. It's just... The fundamental thing is that, her only, other than somebody named Juliet D'Souza, her only career knockout is against Shayna Baszler. And that's not meaningful. It is not.
She didn't even knock out Jessamyn Duke.
No.
Yeah.
And it's not a meaningful, she is somebody who... Like you say, she's a pretty decent technical striker. Really, honestly.
Yeah.
But she doesn't have a lot of power going for her. And Pennington, her striking is so funky. I watched, once again, her most recent fight with Jessica Andrade. And it's just there's so much stuff in there where I'm like, oh, this is so ugly. She just, she tends to be very much a, totally unset up kicks.
Yeah. Lead uppercuts. She did look like she gained a little more pop in her punches in that fight.
And that's the big thing for me. And especially in the clinch, where Correia has this habit of really, I'm going to rush in against you with strikes and then push you against the fence and just kind of lean and try to chip away at you. And that's, Pennington's really good there. She's really good at creating a plumb and just driving really hard knees. Or if she gets you in that mid-range, she actually can fire off some pretty good hooks.
And a really good, short straight right that she showed that Andrade fight. She really has added some snap to those shots.
Yeah, and it's just, it's just so weird because, you said, she's really just not comfortable anywhere until you're beating her up.
Mm-hmm.
That seems to be the thing with Pennington, is it's just anytime she has any space any space at all, it's just kind of it looks so awkward and so weird and functionless.
Which is why I think Correia could definitely win this fight. Like, if she doesn't bring it to Rocky Pennington, then Pennington may never get her game going.
Yeah, but the thing with Correia is that she is going to bring it to Pennington. She is going to rush in and try to swarm her.
Suicidal self-confidence.
Yeah. And so, because of that, I think that Pennington's, you know, she'll get swarmed for like 5-10 seconds, and then she'll grab a collar tie and probably just start doing very bad things to Correia because of it. So, I'm going to pick Pennington, and then I'm probably going to pick her by submission, maybe TKO. I don't, you know, yeah. It's just kind of sucks for Correia because I like her, but she's going to be her own worst enemy here.
Yeah, you get the sense she's never going to ask for an easier fight. Like, she's going to keep expecting to fight top 5, top 10 fighters, you know?
Yeah. Odds on this fight, minus 215 to minus 240 for Pennington. Betch Correia, plus 204 down to plus 165. That doesn't feel wrong. Yeah, neither, like, both wit. The thing with Pennington is she does lose a lot. So, you know, like.
She's barely got a 50-50 record. Yeah, she's.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm going to say those odds are wrong. I'm going to say they should be significantly closer. I think this should be like a 140 on either side kind of fight.
Yeah. Like, you know, and to her, the only thing to her credit in that she loses a lot is that she does tend to lose to much, well, I was going to say much better athletes, but she lost to Leslie Smith, too, who is, I love Leslie Smith, but she's not a way better athlete.
How long ago was that, though? Well, not that long ago.
No. I don't know. That's the thing, like, but Leslie Smith tends to be much more of a, like, Leslie Smith doesn't want to be in, I don't know. Leslie Smith is bigger and she tends to like to strike at range if she can. Like, she's a very rush in and pressure fighter too, but she's much more comfortable using her length and just kind of throwing everything out at you all the time. Which, I mean, Correia, like, she doesn't have that ability. She's too short to do that. Like, she's too short to strike at range all the time.
Yeah, unless she were a little faster, maybe. Like, if she could add some explosiveness, she could pull it off consistently. I will say, I think Pennington has proven she's the kind of fighter who does well when she's – does well learning from fights in which she's overmatched. Like, she benefits from having all of this really tough experience in this division like a lot of other fighters wouldn't. I think she's very confident and very self-assured, not in the kind of crazy, ridiculous way that Correia is, but in a way like, all right, I lost. I don't care that much. I'm going to come back better. And I think she has shown steady improvement.
This is true. All right, on the other side of this, we've got, up next, we've got Beneil Dariush, Michael Chiesa headlining the Fox card. And this is one of those fights that, like, it's cool. I'm glad it's happening. And I am almost absolutely certain beyond a doubt that Dariush is going to win. And
you never feel certain in a Michael Chiesa fight, Zane.
No, I feel pretty certain on this one. Like, I mean, yeah, I feel certain. Like, there's just, I don't know. And this is probably my problem, too, because I think I've picked against Chiesa. I think Jim Miller over him too, I think.
He did.
And to be fair, Jim Miller did beat the hell out of Chiesa for a round.
Everybody beats the hell out of Chiesa a little bit. Not many of them actually beat him, though.
I know. But the guys that do, well, especially like, this feels more like the the Jorge Masvidal fight, frankly.
Than the Joe Lozon one,
Than the Joe Lozon one, or than the Jim Miller, or than the Ali Iaquinta fight, even. Like, Dariush is just, you know, he's too good a grappler. He's too mistake-free in a way that Iaquinta wasn't, and in a way that a lot of the fighters that tend to get caught by Chiesa aren't. a lot of the guys that get caught by Chiesa tend to be very aggressive fighters that are willing to dive in and play his game and make mistakes. Or they tend to, or they're Francisco Trinaldo, who is more of a Hulk than he is actually a good grappler on the ground.
You don't think Chiesa is a good grappler?
No, no. I'm saying that Trinaldo is more of a Hulk
than a good
grappler.
Yeah.
Like, Trinaldo, his submission wins tend to be like, I got on top of you and I smashed you, and then I hit an arm triangle when you
Yeah, that Ilir Latifi submission game.
Yeah. So, Dariush is a very good grappler. He's a very decent, good wrestler. And he's a much, much, much better boxer. Like, Chiesa got dialed up by Jim Miller. Chiesa got dialed up a bit by Mitch Clark. And I love Mitch Clark, but Mitch Clark is not a boxer. Like, that's not the bread and butter of his game. So I got to pick Dariush, and unless Dariush just totally screws up, I think this is going to be a pretty dominating victory in what could be a kickboxing match, frankly. Like, I think Dariush could just keep on his feet the whole time and make Chiesa try to outstrike him, and in doing so, just box him up.
I'm pretty much with you 100%, but I cannot count Michael Chiesa out ever 100%, and that Ramzy Nijem loss is lurking in the middle of Dariush's record like a fart in an elevator. It is just there. It's, you know, and that's the thing. Like, Dariush is, he hasn't been doing this that long. I think he is a very fast learner. I think he's a very intelligent fighter. You know, having
he has been doing this longer than it seems. He has been fighting consistently since 2009.
Yeah,
it's just that's true. He only fought once a year, every year for 2009, 10, 11, and 12.
He started like regularly fighting in 2013.
Yeah,
he's I think he's very smart. Now that he is seriously fully committed to MMA, I think he's going to be picking up new skills really quickly. I think he's going to develop rapidly, and I think he's already proven himself to be a very good fighter. I watched that Michael Johnson fight again, and if it weren't for that kind of weird half knockdown in the first round, like, I don't really have a problem with that fight going to Dariush. Like, it wasn't as close, or it wasn't as one-sided for Johnson as everyone seemed to think it was.
No, Dariush, I didn't see it when it happened, and then I watched it like a week later.
Yeah, does that always happen?
To see, like, it just be this huge wash, and I was like, this is a really stupidly close fight. Like,
yeah, it always happens like that when you don't see it live and you're not caught up in it. You hear all about it, and then you're like, this is not, because everyone overreacts. And that was against a high-volume, kind of awkward southpaw striker, and that's Dariush with less polish, you know? Or Chiesa with less polish. You know, I think Dariush can keep that jab in Chiesa's face. I think he can kick him at range. I think he can maybe take him down if he wants, but I agree with you. I think he might just decide to hold him off and ignore the grappling altogether and use it as a chance to work on his striking against an awkward fighter. So can't count Michael Chiesa out, but Beneil Dariush is the obvious pick here.
Yeah, I just think, I don't know. Yes, I think the big thing with me is that I haven't seen Chiesa. Like, Chiesa will always be this really difficult, funky style matchup because his grappling is so aggressive and strange and hard to account for, and his wrestling is too. But I haven't really seen him get a lot better either. Like, I don't.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't see a much different Michael Chiesa than the guy who beat Ali Aquinta back in 2012, you know?
Yeah, think of Michael Chiesa if he were to like go and work with Cordero or another gym that like specializes in making strikers out of grapplers. If he wasn't just this weird, funky collection of strikes that don't quite fit together, but he goes for it. I think that's the best thing about Chiesa is that when he sees an opening, he will pounce on it.
Yeah, and he doesn't get tired, and he will stay on you no matter what. But I just think that this is one of those, like, your skill ceiling is here. And, you know, this is that kind of fight where you've got somebody who's as skilled as you or more skilled than you everywhere and is a better – it's like the Jorge Masvidal fight. Like, you've got somebody who can match you everywhere and is better.
But
it feels like that.
If Chiesa hurts Dariush like he did Masvidal in the first round of that fight, it could be over. So who knows?
Who knows? Chiesa is the underdog, plus 153 down to plus 130. Dariush is the underdog, or is the favorite, minus 165 down to minus 185. That feels a little close to me, but like we've said, you can't really count Chiesa out. So
yeah, I'm okay with it because I do have that amount of respect for his finishing ability.
All right, and that brings us to the main card. First bout on the main card. Cub Swanson, Hacran Diaz. Take it away. I think it's yours.
Yeah, an odd featherweight fight. A very odd featherweight fight. Cub Swanson, man, he was on such a tear, and then it's like, oh, wait, wrestlers. You know, like he put him against some really good wrestlers, and it's like, oh, shit, he hasn't been fighting those, has he?
Well, and one really good wrestler, and then Max Holloway.
Yeah, right. So basically people who are really, really good in specific skill sets, you know, Frankie Edgar and then yeah. Max Holloway, who's a really, really good striker. And you realize that like Cub Swanson had a pretty close fight with Jeremy Stevens, which is okay. But like other guys who have done that recently have been like Dennis Bermudez and
Stevens broke his hand in that fight.
Right. Yeah. He was doing really well up until he hurt his right hand. Yep. So, you know, I like Cub's game. I like what Cub Swanson is capable of. Mm-hmm. I love seeing Cub Swanson in those rare moments when it all comes together. Like when he started working his jab against Jeremy Stevens, it was beautiful. Or when he started hanging back and being this like small, quick out fighter against Ross Pearson, it was majesty. Like when Cub Swanson finds all of his different techniques and gets into a rhythm, he's really, really good. But other times he's just kind of a weird collection of skills. And so that makes it really hard to rely on him. You know, he can have good takedown defense. He can have good submission grappling. He can have good boxing. But sometimes he's like too busy cartwheel kicking and like looking at you to do all these things in the correct place, in the correct order at the correct time. I think his edge, however, is that he is a lot more dynamic than Hacran Diaz. You know, Hacran Diaz is a tough out. He's big and strong. He's a solid wrestler, good top control, hard kicks, but he's not much of a puncher, not much of a boxer. He doesn't hit that hard with his hands. He's not really comfortable exchanging punches. Sometimes he'll land a decent counter, but he doesn't have that link between his defense and offense that you would need like Cub Swanson does, where Cub Swanson, even if it's inconsistent, will slip a jab and come back with the right hand and hurt you like he did to Dennis Seaver, or like the check hook he hit on Ross Pearson. You know, he has that ability to hang out in the pocket. I think as long as he can keep Hacran Diaz from holding him down, which I do think he can because Diaz doesn't set up his takedowns like Frankie Edgar, then I think Cub Swanson can win. And Swanson, it's easy to forget now because he's on this two fight losing streak, but he was knocking out everybody just before that. So I think he could very well knock Hacran Diaz out late in this fight.
Yeah, I mean, a couple of things to remember too are like in that Frankie Edgar fight, you know, Frankie Edgar went for two decent takedowns early in that fight that Cub Swanson just stuffed cold.
That's right.
And the thing that I remember watching that and thinking to myself, you know what Frankie Edgar's doing, because Frankie Edgar's a really, really good fighter, is he's testing out exactly how Cub Swanson's takedown defense works, and then he's going to spend the rest of the fight cutting through it.
Edgar shoots takedowns the way that the way that Tarek Saffiedine taps leg kicks. He's like, how are you going to check it? Oh, you didn't check it. Okay, now I can go for it.
Yeah. And so, you know, Frankie Edgar, he went in and he just kind of like, he put in a good effort for a takedown. Cub Swanson stuffed it, did that again. Cub Swanson stuffed it. And he's like, okay, so now I see how you stuff this. I'm just going to like cut through every one of these for the rest of the fight and ruin your life. And that's what he did.
Yeah.
But Hacran Diaz is not that guy. Hacran Diaz is much more the, like, I went for this. It didn't work. Okay, I'm going to go for that again. Oh, it didn't work. Okay, I'm going to go for that again. Oh, it didn't work. Okay, I'm going to go for that again. And, like, you know, it's just he might switch from a single to a double or from, you know, he might turn the corner a couple times or something like that, but he's not going to go through this, like, big, complicated takedown chain. And he stands too flat-footed. Like, he's just too willing to wait and see and try and react to what you do. And I think that that is an exceptionally, like, that's the best possible opponent for Cub Swanson, is somebody who's just going to stand in front of him and be like, okay, I'll try and throw out a couple strikes and see what's going on and wait and see what you try to do back. And Cub Swanson can just move around the outside and pick his spots, throw something wild you don't expect, get it and find his rhythm. It's Jeremy Stephens after the broken hand. That's Hacran Diaz. Like,
yeah. With more aggressive wrestling, you know.
With more aggressive wrestling.
But you're right. It's Hacran Diaz is like, I don't know. He's like the Nova Uniao version of Alex Garcia, where everyone in the gym is like, he's super athletic. He's just as athletic as Jose Aldo. He's so good. But then in the fight, it's like, boy, he's not Jose Aldo. Like, it's not, he's not dynamic. He can't, he doesn't seem to know how to change things up that way.
Hacran Diaz is, what he is and what he's been is he's the dude that stops Darren Elkins from being a top 10 fighter.
Sure.
Because he's a good enough athlete to stop mediocre athletes who are really good wrestlers from rising up the ranks. Because he's also a good wrestler. Like, he's a good athlete and he's good enough at everything. He's a good grappler. He's a decent enough technical striker, functional technical striker, that if you're not a great athlete, but you are singularly good at one skill, you're not going to beat Hacran Diaz.
His UFC resume is pretty solid. I mean, like, Yuri Alcantara is a really good win. Elkins is a good win. Makhachev is inexperienced, but a solid win. And he was really competitive with Ricardo Lamas.
Yep.
So,
because everybody's competitive with Ricardo Lamas.
It's true, yeah.
But, yeah, like, Hacran Diaz is a very challenging, strong fighter because he's a good athlete and he's not bad at anything. But he's not amazing at a lot of things too. Like, there's a lot of stuff that he's just not, like, against the top, Cub Swanson being a functionally top 10 fighter still, he doesn't have that area where he's just going to really challenge Cub Swanson.
Right.
It's just going to be an athlete with slightly fewer technical highlights against an athlete with more technical highlights.
Right.
So at that point, I really got to pick Cub here. I think this favors him, and it should be, and it's not like, you know, for all the wear and tear Cub Swanson has, it's not like Hacran Diaz has less. So it should be a good way for Cub Swanson to show that he's still got something left as an action talent at the top of the division. Let's see. Odds on this fight. Swanson is the favorite, slight favorite, minus 118 up to minus 135, or 140, actually. Hacran Diaz, the underdog, plus 110. Down to plus 100. I think that's a little narrow given the style matchup. I mean, we don't know. Cub Swanson could just be shot, but he was like, it, you know, for as good a showing as Max Holloway put on Cub Swanson in his last fight, like, it took a long time. It took a while for Holloway to wear Swanson down.
True. That was, he had a very close first round. It took a while for him to like be firmly in control of the fight.
Yeah. And so it's not like Swanson's just at this point where he's just like getting blasted and going away in first rounds because he's so shop-worn. He's a very competitive, he can still be a very competitive fighter. And so I honestly do feel like these odds are a little slim to me, given that Swanson's not showing that he's just shot and Hacran Diaz isn't dominant.
Oh, yeah. They are narrower than I thought, actually. I didn't even hear you say the numbers before. I just assumed, because last time I saw, I think they were in like the plus 150, 160 range for Diaz, which I'd be okay with.
Mm-hmm.
This is basically even fight odds, and I don't think it's an even fight.
No, I think that Swanson should be a reasonable favorite to win. But the thing, and the difficulty there is that he's not probably, he might finish him, as you say, but Diaz is really tough. And so that's not like an easy pick to make. Like, oh, maybe you can get better odds, Cub Swanson, by, let's see, Cub Swanson via TKO KO is plus 345. So, you know, those are some good odds, but Diaz is really tough.
Never been knocked out.
Yeah, so not a great bet. That brings us to a catchweight bout, Khabib Nurmagomedov versus Darrell Horcher. And Connor, I believe this is yours to take away.
I'm very happy to have Khabib back, and I'm even happy to have him in a tune-up fight. I have no complaints whatsoever. I can complain that Ferguson Khabib isn't happening because I think that's an amazing matchup, and I think it will happen again someday, and I hope it does at the very least, because those are like two of the strongest, most interesting up-and-comers in this division right now. But I think Khabib has been out for over 2 years at this point. He's had numerous injuries, several of them knee injuries. I think one of them was unspecified. And he could use a guy on short notice who is dangerous but not ready for him, you know, like that he could use that. So, I'm picking Khabib Nurmagomedov. Too good in the transitions, too sneakily good as a striker in general, too good at pushing a pace, too good at controlling the cage and the location of the fight. Darrell Horcher is dangerous. He can plant his feet and counter pretty well, but he likes to square up and exchange with guys, and I don't think that's a good way to go with Khabib, who not only can take a good shot, but is pretty sneakily hard to hit and definitely good at finding opportunities when you start, you know, sitting down and throwing at him. So, yeah, I like Khabib Nurmagomedov, and I wouldn't be surprised to see a TKO or a submission in this fight, just because Horker's tough, but he's only had 9 days to prepare. So the kind of pace Khabib puts on him, I could definitely see him being dead tired in the third round and giving up a rear naked choke or getting beat up from half guard or something.
Yeah, I could easily see that. And the thing I want to say, though, is I'm really glad the UFC picked up Darrell Horcher, because he looks like he'll be a really fun action talent and a fun fighter to watch in the future. Like, kid looks like he's going to be seriously enjoyable and entertaining fighter to watch. This is not not a bad pickup for the UFC. It's just he's not winning this fight. That's all, unless something is seriously wrong with Khabib or has seriously changed. Because not only is Khabib this just a bad technical matchup for Horcher and a good technical matchup for Khabib, Khabib is like, he's top 1% athletes in MMA. Just from a pure like speed, dynamic movement perspective, he's just an amazing athlete.
And one of the most intelligent fighters in MMA right now. Yep. Like the way he puts his techniques together, the way that he goes from pressuring to fighting on the outside, he's very, very smart, or at least has a really good feel for what to do and when. And also, I mean, Khabib is still 27, so he's got a little bit of a break from having that long layoff and the injuries, better chance of recovering. And if you watch his UFC fights in order, he has consistently gotten better. Like the Khabib that fought Kamal Chalarus would not have beaten Rafael dos Anjos, nor would the Khabib that fought Abel Trujillo. He was like way more comfortable even than he was in his third UFC fight when he fought RDA. So,
yeah, Khabib's getting better fight to fight. We have to assume that's going to keep happening too, because his coaching is really great. Like we've seen we've seen Abdulmanap, how he's. All these fighters that are training with Khabib, and they're all getting brought along, and they all tend to be well-coached fighters.
Islam Makhachev.
Yep. And Nurmagomedov, because of his striking style too, doesn't leave himself, like, he is open to being countered, but it's very hard to figure out when to counter him, because he's not coming in with typical, like, here's my, 1-2 wooden boxing combination that leaves me open to be hit. It's, here's my leaping left hook that I will now immediately be picking your ankle from. And
he knows when he's open. That's the thing. Yeah. Like he has an awareness of when he's off balancing himself, and he's usually ready to roll under the counter.
Yep. So he's a tough fighter to counter for a counter fighter like Horcher. And if Horcher does get the, land a shot he likes, he will square up and try to land a lot more. And that just puts him in exactly the position Khabib wants to, that's the Abel Trujillo strategy.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of thing that lets somebody set a new takedown record on you.
Yeah.
Khabib Nurmagomedov. So it's just a great matchup for Nurmagomedov. It should be a great showcase for his return. And I'm glad to see Horcher in the UFC, and I hope this just doesn't derail him too badly. Mm-hmm. Odds on this fight, Nurmagomedov coming in at a heavy favorite, -800 to -1100. Darrell Horcher, the underdog, plus 760 to plus 490. My only hesitation there is with Khabib's time on the shelf. And that's it. And that brings us now to our co-main event, Rose Namajunas, Tecia Torres. And this is, I'm kind of sad they're playing this back because I don't know. I don't like seeing rematches without a necessity kind of thing. And Torres pretty clearly beat Namajunas the first time. But I do think this will be a much, much different fight. And the tricky thing for me here is, so I watched, I went back and I watched Namajunas versus Paige VanZant, and I watched Torres versus Jocelyn Jones Liebarger. And Namajunas has a very Jones Liebarger style to her game, where she's very much like, I'm going to chase you down with striking combinations in somewhat straight lines aggressively, and a very like pursuing aggressive style. That in that Liebarger fight, it fit Torres really well because she could circle out, wait until Liebarger overextended herself or had stopped throwing and was in this like, okay, I threw, now you throw mode, and then just come back in and overwhelm her with really quick combinations and then slip right back out. Thing is that Namajunas is a lot faster than Jones Liebarger. A lot faster. And she's more dynamic. And Torres, by the end of that fight, Torres got clipped and got beat up a bit. Like, it's not always a style that works for Torres because it is that classic, like, the volume striker who needs to out-volume their opponents because they're not going to knock them out. They're not going to win any other way by then the chipping away with strikes over the course of a fight. And I don't know. I think, like, part of me says Namajunas should take this because she's on such a roll. She looks like she's improving a lot fight to fight. But I do, I also, like, Torres is not Paige VanZant. Torres is a much different, much better fighter at staying outside, at picking her moments than Paige VanZant, who tends to be this very clunky, wooden, I'm just going to try and bully you and sit in front and I need the clinch. Like, Paige VanZant needs the clinch to win, where Namajunas was just able to kind of wreck her.
Do you remember when Justin Buckles was like, you win your fights by being aggressive, Paige. Go be aggressive. And she started the third round with like a flying jump kick. I was like, oh boy. Like, it's not going to change. She's going to keep losing these rounds.
Yeah. Torres is not that fighter. Like, no. She has a much better, cleaner approach to how to win rounds. So... and Namajunas' thing in the past has been a difficulty in finding a consistent process that wins her rounds. She looked great against Paige, but Paige also just kind of fed herself to Namajunas. So this makes it a very tough fight for me to pick. Like, it's a very difficult matchup because it's a fight that I think, we know that Torres has beat Namajunas in the past. It wasn't like they were wildly outmatched with their level of experience at the time. They were pretty similarly skilled fighters, similarly experienced fighters, rather. I'm going to pick Namajunas because I think she's accelerating more quickly. She's shown more development in her game, and I think she will continue to show more in this fight. She has more power, and if she can force Torres into clinch exchanges, I think she can win those now in a way she couldn't earlier.
Yeah.
But I'm not 100% confident in it.
Well, the first, so you're going with Namajunas?
Yeah.
The first Namajunas-Torres fight was fairly close for a while.
Yeah.
It was very competitive. It was basically the prequel to Namajunas' title fight with Esparza, where she was like, had no self-control, was really, really reckless, and that is how she was up until that Esparza fight. And only recently has she shown a change. The thing that I think is we've known for a long time that Namajunas is very athletic, very fast, surprisingly powerful for her frame, picks up skills really quickly. That's why a lot of us, including me, picked her going into that Esparza fight. We're like, oh, she's too dangerous. Yeah, I know you didn't, but I did. I was like, she's just too dangerous. Esparza is going to be in there with her for 25 minutes, blah, blah, blah. Well, Namajunas fighting that style couldn't go 25 minutes. And what I really like is that as she has developed, Namajunas has severely cut back on the number of things she does. She has refined herself. She's like, okay, I don't need to be throwing like 5 switch jump kicks per round. Like, it's not that high percentage of a technique. I'll save it for when maybe they get used to my jab and I need something different. And she fought Van Zandt. Yes, Van Zandt's not a good corollary to Torres, but Van Zandt, a lot of people, including me, did expect Van Zandt to give her some difficulties because she's so aggressive, because she's so strong, because Namajunas has been in the past so willing to give up position and be reckless. And she was not reckless in any phase of that fight.
Yeah,
she was so poised and so calm. She was being constantly reminded by her corner not to get worked up and try to go for the finish, just to let it happen. So she never gave up position on the ground to go for a submission that wasn't quite there yet. She just floated and stayed on top and transitioned to a new dominant position. On the feet, she never rushed in recklessly. She never went for a crazy technique. It was like, I don't think she threw a single punch in that fight that wasn't a jab, a cross, or a hook. I think it was all very, very basic. And I like that for her going in against Torres, because I think if she can try to keep Torres at range and be this disciplined, calm fighter, then she's going to have a shot, because ultimately what happens is Torres is going to try to close the distance at some point, because she's a clinch fighter. She's an in and out fighter. You know, she likes to be in close and out far away. And if she can't deal with Namajunas' reach far away, she's going to close the distance. But Namajunas also showed greatly improved wrestling skills, clinch fighting, and possibly physical strength as well in that Paige Van Zandt fight. So I like Tecia Torres. I like the way that you talk about women's fighters too, Zane, because a lot of people, like with Betch Kohea and Tecia Torres, people see these fighters that aren't always exciting or that have bad moments, and they're like, ah, they suck. Like, a lot of people think Tecia Torres sucks, and a lot of people think Betch Kohea sucks. And it's insane. Like, and Tecia Torres isn't even Betch Kohea. She's a super prospect. She's very athletic and very young and very talented. But she does have her limitations. You know, she's proven herself, but she's a kind of a one-handed fighter. She doesn't have that very dynamic fight-ending ability in really any phase. She's mostly control and mitigation. And I think she's going to end up getting a little too predictable, and that Rose is going to pick her apart a bit on the feet. And I think that it probably... I don't think anybody will dominate on the ground, actually. I think Torres is not going to be willing to play with Namajunas' guard, and I think that Namajunas is not going to be so willing to go for submissions against the savvy Torres that she ends up locking anything in. So I think we'll probably see a lot of this fight decided on the feet, and I think Namajunas wins a decision.
Yeah, that's kind of how I see it, too. I think she's developed, she's calmed down, and she's just too powerful and fast. Like I said, even in that Liebarger fight with Torres, she was clearly winning it, but by the end of it, she started getting tagged up pretty bad.
Yeah.
And it's just because, like, Torres' style is so, like, it's so high movement and high, like, volume based to keep rounds won, that as she starts to get worn down, if she slows down at all, she suddenly is, like, stepping right into somebody's wheelhouse.
Mm-hmm. And you know, Namajunas is not only faster than Jones Liebarger, like you said, but I think she's a better boxer in terms of how she strings her punches
much
together.
Better.
She's got, not only is she, I mean, I like John Crouch, you know, I like John Crouch, but John Crouch is not Trevor Whitman when it comes to boxing. No. Trevor Whitman's a very good tactical coach, very good at saying, like, okay, you need to feint the jab, or you need to stick it in her chest because she's ducking, and then you're going to put the right hand behind it. Like, he's going to give her those specific details on how to set up her strikes to keep Torres from getting away.
Yeah, and I expect Namajunas to have grown more, too, for this fight. So
She's matured a lot. She seems to have really matured mentally, but she still has that 23-year-old talent, which is a really dangerous combination.
So Namajunas is the favorite, minus 217 to minus 249. Tecia Torres is the underdog, plus 200 or plus 209 down to plus 170. I don't know that it's wide, but it feels a little wide given that this is a fight Torres has already won. Like,
it feels too wide to me. Yeah.
Yeah. It feels too wide given that we've already seen Torres win this. I think Namajunas wins it. You think Namajunas wins it. But Torres, like, Namajunas, you know, in that Paige VanZant fight, she still did, like, she does kind of rush at people on these kind of straight lines. It's just that Paige VanZant had no ability to get away from that at all. And Namajunas, or and Torres does have the ability to get away from that. She is very good at staying on the outside, mm-hmm. picking a spot, and then when you try to come after her, she's not there. And if she can do that, she could frustrate Namajunas into breaking down some of the fundamentals of her game that right. she's built up.
Because we know that Rose has matured, but how does her maturity hold up under duress? You know, like yeah. Paige, like you said, Paige VanZant was just giving her opportunities, and her the test for Rose in that fight was to not get too excited about yep. all the opportunities she was getting to finish. In this fight, yeah. she's going to have very few.
Exactly. So it's an interesting fight, and I'm really interested in it. It's just, it's also, like I said, it's a little weird to see a rematch of a fight where it's like, well, somebody won this fight. Let's move on to something new. But it should be a good one.
I like it. I think I'm excited to see it.
And that brings us to the main event. Glover Teixeira, Rashad Evans. Take it.
Is this a real letdown of a main event after this card? I'd rather see Namajunas Torres as the main event. I think it's a more meaningful fight. You know, like whoever wins that fight's probably fighting Jan Jacek or Gardelia next for the title.
True.
So I don't know. you know, Rashad Evans. People thought I was crazy for picking Ryan Bader over him, but like I have never thought Rashad Evans was as good as everyone else does. And it's
Which
not
that funny point here. At the start of his career, nobody thought Rashad Evans was as good as Rashad Evans thought he was, and then he won a title.
Isn't that the crazy thing? And now everyone overrates him. And it's not that Rashad Evans is bad, but Rashad Evans has very specific and very limited skills. He has a hard right hand, and he relies on it a lot to land his strikes. He relies on waiting for you to lunge in and hitting you with that big right hand, or quickly closing the distance and hitting you with that right hand. I don't think he still has that same ability that he demonstrated in the Rampage fight to, you know, work his strikes off of his takedowns. I think he's lost a little bit of that speed, but he is still a lot more explosive than Glover Teixeira, a lot faster. He's still got a great blast double, and so he could be a really dangerous matchup for Teixeira in terms of putting Teixeira on his back. You know, I think it's fair to say Rashad may be the most explosive fighter in this division, other than maybe OSP. In terms of like sheer, you know, 0 to 60 kind of speed and power, he's got that. And the wrestling technique to go along with it. But like, he's not going to hurt Glover Teixeira with a right hand on the feet, and that's about all he's going to throw. And even if he gets him off of his feet, I think it'll look a lot more like Teixeira versus Cummins, who is a similar kind of wrestler with that quick double, the quick reactive double, and a lot less like Phil Davis, who is great at riding his opponents and grinding on them in the clinch and making it difficult for them to get up and keeping his weight on them. That's not really Rashad. Rashad is all about that entry and the takedown. So if he can't keep Teixeira down, then Teixeira is probably going to react the same way he did in the Cummins fight, which is to just keep coming and keep countering that flicking left hand and keep slipping the right and looking for the left hook. And I think eventually he's going to land it. You know, I just think he's going to be too relentless. He's got 5 rounds to work, and I think Glover can keep his pace for a pretty long time as long as he's not being punished by John Jones. You know, we saw that in the OSP fight and the Cummins fight. He can keep a pretty good clip for a while, and I don't think Rashad probably can anymore. Rashad's 36 years old, and he's had, you know, more punishment than Glover, who I think is the same age, but I think Rashad's had more wear and tear and injuries, and I just don't think Rashad is the same kind of 36 that Glover is still. So I like Glover Teixeira. I think he'll probably knock Rashad out after Rashad tires, maybe like in the third round of this fight. I mean, a final thing I'll say here, Dan Henderson badly hurt Rashad Evans when they fought. And that was 2 years ago. 3 years ago. So that's too recently to have been hurt by Dan Henderson. That's just what I'm saying.
Well, I mean, yeah.
It wasn't even Dan's right. It was a jab. A jab, and it put Rashad on skates. It's just too – how can you trust that man?
Yeah, I think the thing with me right now is that Rashad's not fighting enough anymore for me to really know what to expect here.
Yeah.
Like, he took a huge layoff before that Bader fight. Then he didn't look good. He didn't look comfortable. So he could look more comfortable now. But it's been, you know, another like 8 months since that fight happened.
And Teixeira is not really easier than Bader.
No. And
it's not a step down.
I watched their last couple fights. And yeah, Rashad is still faster. His hand speed is faster. He closes distance faster. He's still got a big edge there on anybody, just about.
Mm-hmm.
Especially on Teixeira. But Teixeira is, you know, he's just so, like, stupid hard to hurt. And if he can, like... And the thing is that once Rashad doesn't have the confidence that he can get something done, that he can hurt somebody, that he can make them go away, he tends to just kind of wait.
Yeah.
And just kind of sit back and just... see, you know, let them take control of the fight. And
if the Dan Henderson anecdote wasn't enough, just think back. The year is 2013, and Rashad loses a tepid decision to Little Nog. Like, yeah. Sometimes if he just doesn't get the right kind of matchup to feel like he's comfortable, if Rashad is not comfortable, he doesn't win. I think that's a good way to say it.
That is the way to put it. And you know, even that Quentin Jackson fight was shit ugly. Like, that was a terrible fight.
you remember I didn't think it was that bad. I enjoyed it.
They spend most of that fight just circling and looking at each other in the, like, waiting for one of them to maybe do that. I think there was, like, one moment where, Rampage caught Rashad or something like that and swarmed
him. Rashad knocked Rampage down or stunned him and then took him down. There were some good moments. It was a lot of tension because of the narrative. So that's why it was enjoyable. But it wasn't action-packed.
No, it was not an action-packed fight. Beyond that, the only fights where Rashad has absolutely just, like, ruled over an opponent are Tito Ortiz and Chael Sonnen.
Yeah, like, both passed their primes at the time that he fought them.
Yeah. And so...
the Phil Davis fight was good for him, I will say that.
It was good for him, but it was also just a matchup of MMA wrestling styles kind of thing.
Yeah.
And that's just not what's going on here with this Teixeira fight. So I think it's just one of those things where Rashad doesn't get comfortable and he gives Teixeira the ground to close him down and keep throwing that straight hook combo that Teixeira loves so much.
Does he have any other combinations?
I don't think he does. And that's it. Like, that's just, it plays out like that. And either Rashad slips up at some point and gets cracked and hurt by it, or he just kind of gives away the rounds, waiting for a point where he can take control and not finding it. So, I got to give it to Glover Teixeira, probably by TKO, but that's definitely my pick as well. Teixeira is the favorite here. Minus 192 up to minus 220. Rashad Evans is the underdog, plus 186 down to plus 160. Now, I got to run out of here because do you have any betting tips really quick? If you've got any, make them, but I got to run out of here because I
got really. It's not a very bettable card, I don't think.
It really isn't. Some fights are a little too far apart, but even still, we're picking the favorites in those fights usually. Mm-hmm. And the fights that we're split on are basically fights that look dead even.
Yep.
So, on that note, this has been Zane Simon, Connor Rebush of Bloody Elbow. You can find me on Twitter at TheZaneSimon. You can find Connor on Twitter at BoxingBush. Give this video a thumbs up. That's That'll help us out over on YouTube. Subscribe to MMAnation.com. That way you get all the rest of our great content. Thanks everyone for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Bye.